Mis hermanos, iniciamos la segunda semana del tiempo de Adviento, este tiempo de preparación para el encuentro con Jesús, ya sea cuando nos llame a su presencia, cuando venga en gloria, y también para celebrar la primera venida de Jesús, el nacimiento, el día de la Navidad. Entonces, la palabra de Dios que escuchamos hoy en el Evangelio de San Lucas invita a que reflexionemos en algo muy importante para el tiempo en el que nos toca vivir, que estamos viviendo. Es casi sarcástico la manera como Lucas nos presenta esta realidad, que era una realidad en el tiempo de Jesús y también lo es ahora para nuestro tiempo. Entonces, ¿qué es lo que nos está queriendo decir San Lucas en el Evangelio que acabamos de escuchar? Nos habla que el 15º año del César Tiberius, el César en el tiempo del Imperio Romano, era la máxima autoridad que representa poder, riqueza, opulencia. El César era considerado el Dios sobre la tierra para los romanos. El César era la cabeza, el centro de todo ese vasto imperio que llegó a ser el imperio más grande de la historia de la humanidad, del Imperio Romano. El César representa ese poder, esa autoridad, riqueza, opulencia, todo eso. Y después dice también, habla de el gobernador Herodes, representante del César en las diferentes localidades, tenía sus reyes representantes también. Habla de otros tetrarcas también. Está San Lucas presentándonos, y también habla de los pontífices Anás y Caifás. Está hablando Lucas de los poderes del mundo. San Luke in the Gospel today is presenting us with this detailed description of the powers in Jesus' time. He's presenting us the highest and greatest of all powers in the time of Jesus. And this is also a little parenthesis here, because some still now, I mean, there are times in history where when this becomes very popular, and I have heard, not too many times, but I have heard people, especially young people, saying that, well, I don't believe if Jesus was real. If Jesus really existed, I think Jesus is just a mythical character that people believe in, but I don't think he's real. I don't think he really existed. Okay, that is, of course, nonsense. And today in the gospel, we are hearing some of the proofs, because There are characters that and times and descriptions in the gospel of actual and real things that happened. Events, governors, Caesar Tiberius really existed, Herod, and all those characters. So if anybody would want to create a mythical character, it's never going to relate that imaginary character with actual real characters. So that is nonsense to believe that Jesus didn't really exist. So this we see here one of the proofs of actual, factual, historical data of the times of Jesus. In addition to all the archaeological data and all the other data that we have that proves, you know, that this is real. Okay, so let's put that aside. So what is Luke telling us when he talks about these pious powers in the times of Jesus? The Caesar, the highest power in the whole empire. Those of you who are studying history, and you study that the greatest of all the empires was the Roman Empire. But Caesar is the one that represents all this power, military power, political power, economical power, all the kinds of powers, all of it is represented by Caesar. Caesar was also considered in many ways God on earth. And Caesar and the governors and kings and high priests, they are all the powers, the highest powers that the world knew at that time. And they represent not only that power, but also the authority and the political, the religious, the cultural, everything. Okay. So then Luke tells us, the Gospel of St. Luke tells us, all of this exists and it was there, and the Word of God came from the desert, from a prophet. The Word of God came not from the powers of being, not for the forces and the finances and all the things that all this represents, but the Word of God came from the desert by a prophet, John. What is he telling us? This is almost laughable that he's saying, for those of us who are seeking God, you are not going to find him in the temporal powers. In what the world offers you, you're not going to find God in what the world offers you. Okay, that makes sense. I hope it does for most of us. But how is that relevant to us? In the culture in which we live in today, the world, society, people like you and I are seeking to find meaning, satisfactions, fulfillment, happiness, and all of these beautiful and good things in the temporal powers, in the powers, in the things that the world offers. And guess what? We cannot find them there. We cannot find what we're seeking for, what our heart is seeking, we cannot find it in what the world offers us. But we can find it only in God. How does this happen? All of us are meant for only one thing, for eternal life. We are meant to be eternal. We are meant to be eternal. That is our purpose. Not for this life that ends sooner or later, but we are meant for eternal life. The world cannot give us eternal life. The world cannot give us eternal life. Only God can give us eternal life. That is why, no matter how hard we try to find in what the world offers us, to find happiness, fulfillment, joy, and everything that we aspire and desire for, we're never going to find that fulfillment in the world, because we are not meant for the world. We're meant for eternal life, for God. And we have tons of examples up and down the centuries of people who have found power, money, pleasures, satisfaction, authority, everything that you can possibly think and probably desired. A greatness, even in mind and sciences, but they cannot find eternal life there. And there, they did not find the fullness of their satisfaction. I don't know how many of you know, I think most of you know, that the letters that were discovered from Albert Einstein to his daughter, have you heard of those letters? Have you seen them circulating in the social media? Look them up. Letters of Albert Einstein to his daughter. Einstein, one of the greatest scientists ever existed, discovering of the relativity theory and then all the consequences that brought and the lifestyle that he lived, he writes to his daughter, and he asked that those letters would not be open until so many years after his death by his daughter. And he says to his daughter, all of that did not give me what only God can give me. And he asked his daughter, this greatest scientist, he asked his daughter not to ever forget about God. Because only God, she can find the fulfillment that we seek. All of us. Okay, so that's just one of many, many examples. All right. So that is what the gospel is telling us today. When it's comparing or contraposing the powers of the world versus the design of God for us. El Evangelio entonces San Lucas está hablándonos de todos estos poderes del mundo. Y nos dice que ahí no está Dios. Dios viene, dice, por un profeta del desierto. Y ahí llega la palabra de Dios. Nos está invitando a reflexionar de que cuando buscamos nosotros el sentido de nuestra vida, la razón de nuestra existencia, cuando nosotros buscamos la felicidad plena, cuando nosotros buscamos aquellas cosas que como seres humanos buscamos y deseamos, no vamos a encontrar esa plenitud en los poderes del mundo, sino solamente en las cosas de Dios. ¿Por qué? ¿Por qué? Porque hemos sido creados para la vida eterna, no para la vida del mundo. This world offers us great and wonderful things. Don't get me wrong. The world offers us great and wonderful things, and we ought to pursue those things to the best of our ability. Like what? Love, family, entertainment, knowledge, education, career, health. There are many things that, of course, the world offers us, and there are many ways in which we can't have that, and that's okay. That's okay to work for that and to apply ourselves to do better in our career, in our profession, in our studies, and even financially to succeed and do better. But that is not our ultimate purpose. That is not our ultimate purpose. Think of Einstein. It's God. God is what gives us our ultimate purpose, which is eternal life. Only in Him. Okay. So, ¿cómo fue? ¿Qué tiene que ver esto con el Adviento? El Adviento es el tiempo en el que todos nosotros reflexionamos en cómo estamos viviendo nuestra vida y cómo estamos tal vez nosotros dejándonos absorber por las cosas del mundo y olvidándonos de las cosas de Dios. Adviento es un tiempo de reflexionar y decir, ok, ¿cómo estoy yo viviendo mi vida? ¿En qué me estoy ocupando? ¿Cuáles son las prioridades que estoy teniendo? Y en el Adviento retomar y arreglar esas prioridades para que reflejen que yo tengo mi último propósito en Dios, no en las cosas que el mundo me ofrece, en los poderes o placeres o diversiones, todas esas cosas, que no son malas, muchas de ellas son cosas buenas, pero no son mi último propósito para lo que he sido creado. Okay, so the second part of the gospel tells us, that's why we hear the prophet saying, prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord. Advent is the time in which we apply ourselves to prepare the way. Why? Because if we don't stop and think of, okay, how am I doing on encountering God in my life? In everything that I do, in everything that I am about, how is God being part of that? If I don't stop and do that, then I'm going to get all over the place, and I'm going to get lost and forget about my ultimate purpose, which is being with God. So he tells us, straighten the ways, lower the mountains, fill the valleys, smooth the roughness of the paths, so that you can encounter the Lord, so that the Lord can come to you and you to the Lord. God can come to you and you to God. What is that talking about? What does that mean? Okay, let us translate that to our language. The mountains, the valleys, the crooked and the rough ways. What is that all about? It's about us. It's about each one of us. The mountains, think of those high mountains that we get up on top of. The mountain of our pride. The mountain of my attitude. The mountain of my selfishness. The mountain of my jealousy. The mountain of it's all about myself. Those are the mountains that we need to lower ourselves. That we need to lower those mountains. The crookedness of our ways, of dishonesty, the crookedness of our vices, the crookedness of our bad things that we know about ourselves more than anybody else. You know, we know what we're doing. The crooked things that we need to straighten. The valleys, those deep valleys, those voids, those holes that need to be filled. The absence of prayer, the absence of going to church every Sunday, the absence of going to confession and receiving communion, those are the holes, the valleys that need to be leveled, that need to be filled, so that I can have, so that I can prepare the way to the for the Lord. So my friends, as we enter now the second week of Advent, I invite you to spend some time thinking, what are those mountains that in your life you need to lower, the valleys that you need to fill, the paths that you need to make straight? This Advent is about that. En este tiempo de Adviento estamos llamados también nosotros a enderezar nuestros caminos, a bajar nuestras montañas, a rellenar nuestros valles para preparar el camino para el Señor. ¿Cuáles son las cosas en las que hemos dejado tal vez que los poderes y las cosas del mundo nos absorban y nos hemos olvidado de las cosas de Dios? ¿Cuáles son las cosas que debemos de enderezar en nuestra vida para preparar así el camino del Señor? En esta segunda semana de Adviento, recordemos esa invitación que nos hace el Señor de no poner nuestra confianza, nuestra razón de ser en las cosas que el mundo nos ofrece. Hay cosas buenas y muy buenas y hay que hacerlas. Educación, cultura, formación, familia, trabajo, tantas cosas buenas. Pero nuestro propósito es, el último propósito es la vida eterna, que solo Dios nos la puede dar. Amén.